desperado. Sitting in a old Monte Carlo. A man whose heart is hollow. Take it easy. I'm not trying to go against it. Actually, I'm going with you. So we'll do it right now. And we'll make that recording available on our website, nypassforce.org. You could join us as a member and support our efforts such as today. We will do kind of a Q&A or discussion session at the end, so you can post your questions in the chat, or you can also unmute yourself at the end and we can engage in a little bit more of a discussion. So Henry, please take it away.
Thank you so much. A pleasure being here. As mentioned, I'm Henry. I should say we're going to go through a lot of pretty technical content, deep dive on electric grids and how they work. And kind of as it relates to building energy modeling, and is there a way to like bring those two together and really start talking about carbon in the building context? I find that if you have questions as we go throughout, I'll pause. If there's a particular question on a slide, please interrupt, raise your hand, somehow raise attention, because it may be useful to dig into that topic when we arrive at it. So please feel free to interrupt. As we get started here, I should mention that just a little bit of background on Watt Time is that we're a nonprofit based in Oakland, but we have people all over the US and even the world. We're affiliated with RMI, but what we really do is we've worked really hard to understand the electric grid in a lot of detail to understand when you make a change in the grid, how emissions change. And so we think about a whole array of different topics for that data. And we care a lot about authentic data and making it actionable so that you can actually make useful, meaningful decisions based on it. And this today, I think we're really going to focus on building energy modeling and kind of how to think about design in relation to carbon. I really like to start with this slide. It's my kind of like introduction to timing and location and how important those things can be from a carbon standpoint. So on the left side here, we have a building in California that consumes this much electricity and then has also gone out and could have procured the same amount of electricity, solar, either in California or Virginia. So you're net zero energy on an annual basis, something we're all kind of comfortable with. But the emissions implications of that are a little more complex. And so on the right side here, you actually have that same building in California. And this is the emissions it causes by adding load to the grid. Conversely, adding that much renewable energy to the grid, specifically solar, only displaces, you know, 3/4 of the same amount of emissions that you cause. And that's really due to timing. Because that solar is producing in the middle of the day, it's displacing a mix of both natural gas and renewables. So it's actually not as effective as it could be because of the timing of when it generates. And so that's the key issue of like timing. When you consume electricity or when you generate electricity really matters. And then from a location standpoint, if you take that same amount of electricity that this solar plant produces in California, but instead of producing it in California, you produce it in West Virginia, instead of displacing natural gas and other renewables, you'll actually be displacing coal. And so the emissions is like the emissions prevented are 2.5 times higher. So if you start to think about carbon independent of electricity, or is not like perfectly linearly linked to electricity, you begin to see that both where you consume electricity and when you consume it matters a lot. And that's really the foundation of all of our insights and observations. And I just like to include this quick slide, which is this is the like timing. If you're thinking about timing, you want to avoid these peaks and move as much electricity into these troughs as possible, or efficiency measures that address this peak are more valuable than those at the kind of off-peak periods. And that really, we also talk about automated load shifting. So if you have an EV or a smart thermostat or a connected appliance, is there a way that it can make that decision every day? And instead of running in the afternoon, runs in that morning trough or when there's wind curtailment or something like that. And then from a location standpoint, if you're, for example, a large corporation and you're thinking about siting a data center, if you have flexibility, don't put it in a place where if you add load, it'll increase demand for coal generators. It'll actually increase demand on either hydro in Quebec or more solar in California. That's kind of the the location-based aspect. You could also look at it on the other side and say, if I were building a new wind farm, you don't really need to build it in Canada. Maybe building it in the Midwest is more valuable. So we're saying, target those investments to those places that have the most value. And you'll notice that this map doesn't align with any political boundaries that you may be familiar with. These are actually balancing authority or ISO boundaries. And we report, as Wattime, we report emissions that align with these boundaries. So for example, in New York, the NYISO, New York Independent System Operator, controls all of the market operations. Power plants bid into that market and bid out. And so that determines which power plants turn on and off. And so we think that's the most appropriate boundary to understand when you make a change, how do emissions change. It just so happens that the NYISO, it's moving without my permission, that the NYISO boundary aligns with the New York State boundaries. For example, ERCOT is just a part of Texas, CAISO is just a part of California. MISO and SPP cover huge swaths of the Midwest. ISO New England actually covers most of the New England state. So the political boundaries don't necessarily well align with actual grid boundaries. And then has anyone seen a dispatch stack before? This is kind of a chart that is often used to explain how the grid works. I'll launch into it, but each of these bars here represents a different assets in that region. So for example, these are all the renewable assets. These are kind of a mix of different resources, and they're all arranged by the price at which they would operate or bid into the wholesale market, not the price you see at the meter, but the wholesale price. And so if demand is at a high level here, that means all of the units to the left of that need to be running to meet that demand. And if demand increases, they have to bring on additional resources to meet that demand. And that sets the wholesale price of electricity. So you can see as demand swings, the price moves up and down this curve corresponding, and the mix of resources that's available at any given hour changes. So these green bars may not be available in the middle of the day like solar, but the wind might come in the afternoon. And so they're always dispatched first because they're the lowest cost. Does that make sense? Any questions before I launch into the next set?
Lowest cost or price?
Lowest price that they bid into the market. They say, I will bid in at this price. And then the ISO says, you fall under the price cap, we'll dispatch you. You should be running in this given hour.
So we're giving away the renewables in a sense, because that's what this chart is showing. Zero is at the...
What they're saying is they will bid into the market at a negative price because they will operate at a negative price because they actually have other revenue streams like RECs or the tax credits. So that's why you see negative pricing occasionally, because they want to run no matter what. So they will pay you to take their electricity sometime. But that said, if the price is set here at, you know, $30, they get paid $30 because everyone gets settled at the marginal price. With a lot of complexity. Like you might have bilateral contracts, someone may have guaranteed that they take off your power, a bunch of situations like that. I do like to say that cost is not a wholesale cost is or price is not a great proxy for emissions always, because you could have dirtier things lower in the stack. And this is where I want to introduce the concept of marginality. So if you're at this load level at this arrow and load changes, that means they have to bring on those additional power plants. If you would turn on your light bulb, if you add a building, that means that certain power plants have to turn on to meet that resource. And that's what we report when we say marginal emissions. When you change load, how does emissions change? And we think that's a really important concept because not all of the resources in the stack ramp up and down in response to your changes in load. It's always that kind of edge resource. So it better describes, like, you could be in the Pacific Northwest, which is, you know, 75% hydro, but if the remaining 25% is coal and you build a new building, there's no more hydro to go around. They're gonna have to turn up those coal plants to meet that additional load. And so that's why we say the marginal emissions or the marginal impact of your choice is the important kind of measurement in this grid region. That's different than the average emissions, which everyone is probably pretty familiar with, which is if you take the total emissions in the region and divide it by the total generation, that's kind of the typically reported average emissions, but that doesn't tell you if I build a building, if I charge my EV, how will emissions change in that region? Does that concept make sense?
Yes, thanks.
Excellent.
Would that be the same, Henry, for like, let's say I'm renovating a building and so I'm going to save some energy? Would I also want to take into account the marginal emissions in that scenario?
Absolutely. So let's say you have a highly inefficient building and you cut its energy use by 50%. That means that that gas plant on the margin doesn't need to run anymore. You've prevented that gas plant from running by reducing your demand. So it's a really good tool for decision making. Like, if I take this action, what are the emissions implications of that choice? So I introduced this beautiful chart. It's very clear. It has like a dispatch stack. All the resources are cleanly lined up. Unfortunately, the world isn't that clean. And we actually so there are out of merit order dispatch. So there are resources in the Midwest, for example, that are the utilities just decide when they run. And so they're not actually affected by market prices, and you can't affect them by changing your load. And so this perfect dispatch stack doesn't always work. And we actually use an empirical method that looks at the actual emissions coming out of stacks and say, when load changes, how do those emissions change? And so we kind of post up behind this very empirical approach to detecting emissions, marginal emissions specifically. Let's see. I like to quickly talk through like what it looks like in specific regions. I just pulled the California example. Everyone talks about the duck curve in California. We've all heard about the spring ramp. It's always shown on March 31st when there's an oversupply of renewable energy. And what we're really seeing is that we're throwing away increasing amounts of renewable energy every year, gigawatt hours. And that's because the grid is so inflexible. There's an oversupply in the spring that there's just an excess. And we're actually starting to see that emerge in New York as well, especially upstate New York with the large amounts of wind. I anticipate with the aggressive, very aggressive targets that New York has come out with that all the offshore wind and will kind of cause this dynamic to start to increase in New York as well, where there'll be periods where there'll be lots of surplus renewable energy. And if you increase load, you'll prevent certain renewables from being thrown away, renewable energy from being thrown away. So we're starting to see this behavior emerge in Texas, in the Midwest, Germany, Ireland, as there's an oversupply of renewable energy at particular times.
Can I ask a question?
Of course.
Then battery storage or storage of this is like a critical element, or it's not really be part of what you're talking about right now?
We think storage is a critical piece of the story. It's just that if we have load flexibility, that's a cheaper, maybe a cheaper, more effective way of getting there. If you can shift the load in your building, but you don't have to install a multi-million-dollar battery to do that, you kind of are helping solve this problem in addition to all of the storage solutions that we're going to need as well.
Yeah, I love your presentation. Thanks.
There's also a piece related to that. Storage is complex, and we should probably do a deep dive on it, where storage is following the price signal they're receiving at the building, at the meter, which may be unmoored from the grid needs. So if you're chasing demand charges with your storage, which is what we're seeing a lot of storage systems do, those spikes in building demand have no reason to be aligned with like oversupply of renewable energy or low or high emissions periods on the grid. And we're actually seeing storage systems in California and throughout the country increase emissions because they're charging and discharging at the wrong times, because what the building needs has nothing to do with what the grid needs. And it's a signal issue. Like, the signal's not coming from the grid and being transferred to the building, whether that's an economic signal or an emission signal.
I had the chance to talk to the CEO of General Electric, and he talked a lot about smart grid. Mm-hmm. And he actually confessed that one of the things they want to do is use all the electric cars as electric storage. So when you come home and there's still, 100 miles of driving energy in your car, they'll use that for the microwave ovens and the TVs and everything. And then at night when you go to sleep, then they'll kind of charge the car. So the illusion is that you're charging the car after you hook it up. The reality is it's sucking the energy out and then it's putting it back in. And that to a large extent would solve this problem. Storage has always been a problem with alternative energy, especially wind.
And we're already starting to do that, actually. So we partner with NLX. They're the big JuiceNet Green, I think, is their system, where they actually, you come home, you plug your EV in, and we know that you have 12 hours of flexibility before you need it again.
Right.
We say, we'll pick the cleanest 3 hours out of the night and charge it up for you. And so it helps avoid that evening peak. It supports renewables. And so we're trying to say, is there a way to get that into as many devices and as many appliances as possible and uses?
Oh, so you could do that with like a washing machine.
Exactly.
If you had a way to pull it into the dryer so it didn't get dookie.
And dryers are way more important than washing machines. Very true. Because dryers use all that heating energy, whereas washing machines, it's a motor, but the right. heating is the really big, big one. Were there any, Robert, it looks like you might have a question.
Yes, I'm from upstate New York. And we have actually power lines running through our property, which runs from a reservoir that where they pump the water up to the reservoir in the top of a mountain, and then release it to generate electricity. And it seems to me, I don't know if there's a problem with physics, but it seems to me that it's a good way of doing more storage of electricity.
We completely agree. We've also just seen that a lot of the pumped hydro storage is just has been tapped out. All the best hydro generation, a lot of the good pumped storage locations have been used because the economic advantage of them has been recognized and built already. So we need a lot more of it. It's just, it's not necessarily available. Any other questions before we go on a little bit further? Excellent. Valerie, I saw you had some questions in the chat. Did you get those answered?
You've been answering them along the way, so that's good.
Great. So
thank you. Yeah.
Where it starts to relate to building energy modeling, I think, is everyone's familiar with TMY data. So we started to think about, is there a way to like think about carbon in the same way? And so what we started to do is build these trends in emissions where in California, we see this oversupply of renewables in the spring. Is there a different design solution that you would think about there versus the summer where there's an afternoon peak in emissions? Are there certain strategies that are more effective at addressing that evening or afternoon peak? Would this data begin to be helpful to inform designs? And just so that so I'm showing you the data here, like these are the monthly trends we've averaged by month and hour just to see what's going on. And I pulled out specific days so we're perfectly clear about what's going on in that situation. So this is that spring day where there's so many renewables that there's actually an oversupply in the middle of the day. We're still running fossil because that fossil has to be turned on and warm for the evening ramp. But it's no longer responding to changes in load. Whenever load changes, the renewables just fluctuate up and down. And you can actually see that in the jagged line at the top. And then as we get into the evening, those renewables go away and we have to turn on more and more fossil plants to meet that additional load. And then the opposite is really happening in the summer where even though we still have a ton of renewables in the middle of the day, the dirty resources really have to be turned on all day to meet that huge amount of load. And in the evening, we're actually at the highest amount of load because the net load is the greatest then when everyone's gone home and turned on their air conditioning and everything. And that's why you get that super dirty peak in the summer afternoon. And just to make sure I'm illustrating the difference here, this is the spring day and it fits entirely within that summer day, just to give you a sense of scale, entirely beneath the fossil resources. And so what we've actually done is start to think, we know that this is kind of, how do we think about this from a building design standpoint? I pulled a random building that we had meter data for and said, here's its electricity consumption and here's the corresponding emissions. And they don't really talk to each other at all. And how do we begin to like think about design solutions and other things that can can work, and what tools do designers need to start thinking about carbon in a more time differentiated way? And so what we've actually done is we've started to call them TCY, because everyone's familiar with TMY, typical carbon years, where we take 3 years of historical data and we say, we're going to average it by weekday and weekend and hour by month. So you can start to see this trend emerge of, in the spring, there's curtailment. In the summer, there's dirty stuff in the middle of the week. And so then you send us your location, your latitude and longitude, and your simulation year in your energy model. And we rearrange the weekends and weekdays and holidays and send you back an 8760 that you can then compare to your energy model to start thinking about the carbon implications of any of your efficiency measures or system changes or envelope choices. And so we're trying to make this tool available and really kind of, is this useful? Does it answer, begin to answer questions? And so we call, so this would, this typical data is somewhat smooth and is matched to energy model data. Because we use 3 years of historical data because we want to avoid any like instantaneous details, like was it a dry year? Was it a hot year? And that can affect the grid emissions or building demand. And we also, we use the smooth data because 3 years of isn't too long, that we're seeing grids change so fast that we want to be able to capture more recent data, whereas TMY has the luxury of pulling out 30 years of historical data, though that may start changing with climate change. And so we're trying to say, is this like a good middle ground to inform design decisions? We also have that real-time data, and that's where we start to think about controls and like, if you're thinking about dispatching a storage system like a battery, do you actually start doing things differently? Because then it starts to really matter in this particular exact hour today, are renewables being curtailed or is a peaker plant on? And then we can start to like, we have a real-time data, we have a forecast and historical data, so you can train the algorithms and then you can implement those control algorithms in real time in your storage system, in your BMS system. And so that's kind of the other side of the data. We have this normalized smooth data, which is really good for energy modeling. And then we have this real-time and very granular data, which is good for like training control algorithms and implementing controls. And I think those are the two types of data we like to talk about. Before this call, I was talking with the Passive House folks, and they said there's a lot of discussion in the community around like methodologies for assessing carbon. We have a lot of grid data. Like we measure the grid emissions continuously. If there are other ways folks are thinking about applying this data, we'd love to work with you to kind of make this data part of the design process. And definitely useful in that sense.
One thing is, I have had a house in Sweden, and I am Swedish. When they look at the cost of fossil fuels like gasoline, they think that the cost of the gasoline is only about 8% of the impact. The other 92% is acid rain and the acidic rainfall, the infrastructure, statues, bridges. And one of the things they point to is like a bronze statue of a guy and a horse. And, you know, it's had so much corrosion over the last 400 years. Stockholm has things that go back 2,000 years. So it's kind of a nice place to look at aging of materials. But, you know, all of a sudden in the last 10 years, you see this exponential increase in the amount of corrosion. And some of the hotter burning and more complete combustion cars actually make more NOx and SOx. So maybe the right way to think of a fuel is not, you know, what it costs to get it out of the ground and burn it, but the environmental impact, the global warming, the poisoning of, you know, we're losing species and all this. But the you know, there's no free lunch. If you do bad things and it affects the environment negatively, you know, it's not sustainable. You're taking away your ability to do what you want to do tomorrow by what you're doing today. Well, just a thought.
And I think we're really bad at pricing in those externalities, which they affect us all. And I think that's actually one area of research that we're really focused on right now is health impacts of electricity consumption, because a power plant running in New York City has vastly greater impacts on the local community than one in a remote area. And so starting to measure and think about those is something we're putting a lot of research into. Like for CO2, emitting it anywhere has a global impact. But if you emit SOx and NOx in a community, it actually affects respiration, health, asthma, all that. And
that's right.
So we're starting to think about, are those disparities in time even more pronounced? Because at night when load is low, upstate New York power plants may be operating and responding to your load. So if you can shift load to them, that benefits the community locally. So that was the like bulk of the core like grid underlying, how we match it to energy modeling. There's a ton of content related to energy storage, building design, but I just wanted to open it up for any general questions or discussion, or hear how you might use this data, or is there a discussion in what you're, what, how you're using, how you're currently thinking about emissions?
Thanks, Richard. Yeah, so let's open up the discussion. You guys can unmute yourself and you can ask questions.
Well, one thing occurred to me when you showed that diagram of the fridge cycling on and off, and the idea of the smart grid, which we're not near there yet, but the concept that you could synchronize like all the refrigerators in a particular area to cycle on and off at different times, so that basically you flatten that so you don't have these like peaks. And the other thing is maybe we need refrigerators that are more constant operation, much like the way our heat pumps are working, where we don't have these bolts up and down. So there's I don't know how much work is being done on that relative to the grid, because it's a pretty interesting thought right there.
We've definitely put some thought into it. Are you familiar with GEBS, the grid interactive efficient buildings? I think that's where a lot of the thinking is being done on the building side, especially at the DOE. On the device side, we're working with a bunch of different partners to really think about what does it look like to get those controls in devices. And counterintuitively, historically, we wanted a perfectly flat grid, but now we want a more or perfectly flat demand profile. Now we actually want one that responds to fluctuations in solar and wind. So we're starting to say, we want to shift as much load as possible into the midday trough in California, or that late night curtailment in Texas when there's a ton of surplus wind. And so it's starting to like, you want to start to shape your profile to match the available resources. Whereas historically the grid always just responded to changes in load by ramping up and down different resources. So it's going to become a more like blended demand side and generation side system.
Northeast Power Partners up and down the Northeast of the US, they do a lot of demand response and they pay people to go off the grid, and that seems to work pretty well. And then I had a project where we put in a 4.4 megawatt solar array in Edison, New Jersey. And we basically took a passive house approach to 658,000 square foot industrial complex. And we were able to make it carbon neutral in April of 2012. So it's doable.
Definitely doable. What we've seen is that DR is really focused on those 12 peak events a year, like avoiding the peaks. We're really talking about a transition towards continuous optimization, where every day you charge your EV at the beneficial time, not just make sure not to charge it from 6 to 9 on those 3 summer days when there's a grid emergency. And so we're starting to think like, do you pre-cool your building every day? Do you make those decisions consistently where you're actually supporting the grid? Like, is the BMS system smart enough to be able to support that kind of thing? In addition to the structural decisions you've already made about shading and systems that are efficient and consume electricity at useful times.
Can I ask a question about the modeling side stuff, Henry? The I actually have two questions. So first of all, I'm really curious where, I wonder if you could speak a little bit to like where the data is coming from. It seems like a really powerful data set, and I'm really curious about like who's collecting the data and how is it collected? What's the sort of fidelity of the data that you're receiving, and where's it coming from? But I'm also really curious on the modeling side, if you could just speak to a little bit, you know, we're like in the passive house world in particular, we're familiar with using things like the e-grid annual emissions rates from the EPA or something like that, right? To convert your whole year's energy consumption into a rough equivalent carbon emissions. Can you speak a little bit to like using this marginal emissions approach, like how much of a difference are we talking about? Do you think we would see like big differences in some regions? Like are we getting the wrong answer when we use those e-grid emissions rates? Do you think we'd be making different decisions if we were to use these sort of more fine-grained hourly marginal emissions rates? I'm curious to know, like, how big of a difference are we talking about when it comes to these annual emissions versus marginal emissions hourly rates?
Absolutely. I think these are actually pretty interesting and interrelated questions. The data sources are fascinating. So the EPA actually collects stack level emissions data for every plant in the US over 30 megawatts. So they're out there, or the units actually report it to the EPA, and they store it in a database called the AMPD Air Markets Program Database. And they have hourly emissions for every unit in the US coming out of that stack. And it's delivered with a 3-month delay. So we kind of build historical models based on that data to say, when we see demand change in this region, what cluster of conditions are we seeing in real time that we can then say they match these conditions that we saw historically, and these are the types of plants that responded in those conditions. We also marry that with a bunch of real-time data we get from the ISOs, so the big balancing authorities like CAISO, ERCOT, ISO New England, NYISO, and PJM publish a whole wealth of information in real time, like real time load data, price, various resources. And there's also a third data set from the EIA, which is actual real time fuel mix and other information for every balancing authority in the US. And so we stitch those three data sets together to really understand when load is changing in the grid region, how are emissions changing? Does that answer your first question?
Yes, that's really helpful.
And I believe eGrid is actually built on the same database that AMPD that we use. They just use it slightly differently, where they do a bunch of post-processing to arrive at the eGrid values. Actually, within eGrid, you'll notice there's they have a bunch of different tabs. There's unit level emissions, there's plant level emissions, there's state, and then there's even the different FERC-NERC regions that they use. And there's even a tab way at the side that says BA, and that's actually balancing authority emissions. They also report emissions at the balancing authority level. And on that tab, they have non-baseload emissions as well as average emissions. And the average emissions are what we've discussed before, but the non-baseloads is kind of a proxy for marginal, because they're essentially saying which are the power plants that are turning on and off in response to load. And we've actually seen, generally speaking, marginal emissions will be higher than average because the low cost resources aren't often being dispatched at the margin. They'll run no matter what. So you're going to run nuclear no matter what. It's not ramping up and down to meet your demand. If that nuclear goes away, emissions will change significantly. And then so that kind of answers the like magnitude difference between average and marginal, but there's also a granularity question. So the annual factor doesn't really account for that behavior of like there's curtailment in the spring. That won't show up in that average and the annual data, whether because it's averaged together or smoothed out in that sense, as well as like knowing that the peakers are running in the afternoon in New York is a really important design, could influence the design decisions that you make. And I think that's where we see the value in granularity. There are a lot of grids that have pretty flat profiles because they're just running one fuel and there's not a lot of load variation. And so the annual factor in that context is totally fine and will give you meaningful insights about efficiency measures. I think there's a conceptual difference between the average and marginal, which is important to say here, which is the average is kind of apportioning responsibility. It says like, what are all the units running in a region? How do they contribute to electricity consumption? With the marginal, we're truly trying to answer the question, if I add this load in this grid region, how will emissions change? And like which power plants will run more now that there's a new building, which is a conceptually different question than apportioning responsibility.
it sounds too like you're saying, correct me if I'm wrong, but it sounds like you're saying that in grids with high levels of renewable penetration, the difference between those annual emissions and the marginal emissions becomes larger. Am I correct in saying that? So, I mean, certainly it seems like a place like New York State, which is hopefully going to be moving towards large amounts of renewables over the next 20, 30 years, it seems like that would be a type of, that would be a type of state where these types of marginal emissions rates are an important part of our modeling process. Would you agree with that? Is that, am I understanding that right?
Absolutely. And as more renewables are come into New York, when like there could be so much wind added that there's an oversupply at night, which means if you have any strategies in your building, thermal storage, preloading that can take advantage of that surplus wind, that should emerge in the marginal data where you should say, oh, look, there's, we're curtailing it, we're throwing it away in these hours. Is there any way we can use it?
Yeah, because there's, I mean, I've got a number of things here that are sort of related to that. Because like Amar Kataba asked, is there a way to time the running of a heat pump to maximize the COP and the green electricity? And in relationship to that, we've got like, as we electrify buildings and we bring more heat pumps in and we continue to green the grid, right? Like these things start to interact, right? And so like, is like, so the question is, one, is the equipment, is equipment coming out on the market that can actually respond this way? And are there signals coming from the utilities that can actually tell the equipment to behave the way we want it to, right? In terms of like the like, in particular, like the peaking and the load distribution.
So it's starting. To address the heat pump question explicitly, we're actually working on a project with UC Davis that's designing model predictive controls for heat pumps that can actually integrate multiple signals, user comfort, grid costs, grid emissions, and like make decisions about when to overheat and underheat to make sure that they're not just doing their typical loading profile. And I think we're actually starting to see more and more manufacturers of devices begin to start to integrate these controls from the beginning. We work with, like I said, Enel X to build that into their EV chargers. We're also working with a BMS control company out of Canada that overwrites the BMS system and thinks about optimizing for demand charges, for energy costs, and for emissions. I think where we're really seeing it fall apart is that the utility signals are not keeping up with grid needs. Like TOU is a radical concept, and it's kind of a blunt object, and it doesn't have this fine-grained variation.
Time of use,
sorry about that.
Gotta keep up with it's like a whole new set of acronyms.
Oh, I had to learn it all, and it was an uphill battle. And if I say any acronyms that are not clear, please stop me. And so one thing we've seen is there's actually quite a bit of demand from consumers for emissions responsive devices. Like if I gave you the choice to have a washing machine and dryer that ran at the clean time, and as long as it was ready in the morning, you'd probably take advantage of that if it didn't affect your life in that sense. Like there's a lot of load flexibility value, and that might actually be more valuable to you than any DR revenue, because it's cents. You get cents on the per year, a few dollars per year for participating in DR, demand response. So I think we're taking the baby steps towards those signals.
And actually, like, because the load shedding issue, like, because I'm up in Maine right now, and we've had actually a couple of power outages, one in the middle of the day, like on a perfectly clear cloud, you know. And this guy that I don't know if you're familiar with Low Tech Magazine. He's this Dutch guy who's constantly talking about issues of like, why do we need like smart grids and you know, but he does really good research. And one of his things was like, you know, our grid is like typically like 99.95% like reliable. And so if we just like did 99.9% of reliability, he was like did the analysis on the amount of like load, like the amount of equipment that we wouldn't need to put to keep the grid reliable.
It's so massive.
Yeah, it's, well, yeah.
Like something like 50% of the cost of maintaining the grid, not maintain, of operating the grid is captured in like 5% of hours. Because it's that peak periods, you have to keep that plant available and running the rest of the year to be available during those peak periods. And so there's a lot of investment in those high capacity events on the grid. Texas and every market does it differently, and there are a bunch of dynamics at play. And capacity is actually one of the largest costs to utilities, not actual energy costs. So paying a power plant to be available is a larger expense than the actual energy it produces. In Texas, they just let the wholesale price of electricity get to $10,000, and everyone, and that payment makes those plants available to operate for the rest of the year. So they've kind of solved it in a different free market way than paying for availability. Yes, yeah, so avoiding those peaks could have both huge cost savings as well as emission savings, because those peak plants run the dirtiest fuels. We have a jet fuel plant that literally burns jet fuel down the way from us in Oakland. It's in the port, and they turn it on during peak periods and they burn jet fuel. In New England, they have TDF, tire-derived fuel, which they burn in emergency situations in a particular cold snap. You also get weird dynamics, like if it's a really cold period, the natural gas needs to go to residential heating, and there's an undersupply of natural gas, which means they have to burn oil or petroleum products instead of natural gas in the power plant. So there are a bunch of like these, all these systems interact and affect each other.
Most residential, if I'm correct, is like flat rate. Would that make a big difference if we did demand pricing on residential, or at least had some kind, like, would that help like push the market, right?
There's a ton of research into that I don't actually know that much about. I think it does affect, but it doesn't change that much behavior. There's also been talking about real-time pricing for residential, but that is, the uncertainty is pretty harmful for a lot of people. So there are equity issues. So there are a ton of different dynamics at play. TOU will become mandatory next year in California if it's not already mandatory, but it's still, it gives you the macro trends. It doesn't give you the like granular signal necessarily. I think, We quickly touched on energy storage at the beginning. Are you seeing a lot of energy storage in some of your projects yet? Is that starting to emerge?
Nope.
Getting a head shake.
No, not in New York City, at least. Not anything we've seen.
Well, there's that indoor fire code issue in New York, from what I've heard.
There's also, I mean, there's like been a number of articles lately. What are they calling? Lithium mining, it's like the white oil or something like that. It's the mining of that particular on the building scale. I mean, which I don't really understand why we should be. The only reason Tesla is making the Powerwall with a lithium battery, when you could have something larger for a residential use, is because they make lithium batteries already.
Like it's stationary storage is a different game. Like energy density doesn't matter as much for stationary storage as it does for mobile.
And there's been a lot of promising developments, but I don't know why most of this hasn't sort of really like had major market penetration with various storage mediums that aren't as invasive as lithium mining is.
I think it's a lot to do with, we're just higher on the development curve than we are with solar. Like solar went through the same thing 10, 20 years ago, and you know, there was massive investment in it, which forced the price and the barrier down. And I think we're still in the very early stages of that for storage, even though it's starting to be more widespread.
But I've been reading about it for like 15 years, you know, the distributed storage as opposed to grid level storage, right? And
Henry, can I comment about your question about are we seeing in building storage? Our projects are mostly outside the city where the grid is really unstable. You know, one storm can electricity for an hour. A tropical storm could be a week or so. So we are, of course, thinking about that and trying to figure out if there's any way around it. But, you know, unfortunately, every project now is insisting upon having an LP gas generator, which is what we'd like to avoid, of course. But, you know, we don't have the ability to say that your house will even operate on a very low level for even 2 days for what we could do without using a LP gas generator.
We're starting to see projects emerge that are using a combo of solar and storage as backup. Mm-hmm. The reason they like that is because there's no refueling need and your resiliency is substantially longer with solar and storage. Like we've seen some projects get like 180 days of resiliency because they're able to fill and empty. Those are for like critical infrastructure, like grid infrastructure, where they shut off all the non-essential stuff and then they recharge their battery and are able to operate the facility for days on end. And they're not driving trucks in, which may or may not be available during a disaster. That also opens another interesting opportunity where you can, if you invest in a storage system for your building for resiliency needs, that means it's not being used for the vast majority of the time. And you can actually begin to cycle it for emissions or cost savings or a combination. They're starting to like stack the values as much as possible.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bill, for the question. If there are no other questions, I would say, Sarah, yes.
Hi, yeah, I was just really enjoying this discussion, thank you. I'm just curious what other battery technologies you guys were beginning to talk about besides the lithium ion. Maybe address again why Tesla's battery is not in every building that we do, if maybe not Tesla's, but you know, it just seems like such a great marriage, the solar and the battery. Unresidential.
I think what we're seeing is that, in California, that's starting to change. A lot of construction is residential construction has storage now, but we're really seeing that storage is still so cost prohibitive that it doesn't have a payback or it doesn't have a sound financial sense in a building yet, especially non-residential. In residential, we're starting to see because of reduced feed-in tariffs for net metering for solar, storage is starting to make substantially more sense. And there's also with the PSPSs, which are the power shutoffs in California for the wildfires, that people want that storage quite a bit for their residences. So we're starting to see the pressures on storage making it much more likely in California. And I think the same thing happened with solar 20 years ago, where there was a huge incentive program in California where they spent billions of dollars, made it much more affordable, and then started to spread out and become much more widespread in general. And then they're kind of doing that same thing. They're putting $1 billion into storage over the next 5 years as incentives. And I think we're going to see storage prices drop dramatically and become much more widespread. But then we still have that controls mismatch where you put a solar system in your house, a storage system in your house, it doesn't mean you're operating it in a grid beneficial way if you're not receiving a grid signal. Like if you have a flat retail rates, there's nothing telling you when to charge and discharge. And I think that's a piece that we're still missing.
And the other technology that you?
You mean other storage technologies?
Yeah, or something that's not as, because there are a lot of environmental costs to mining all those rare earths and, you know, it's the mining that is concerning.
I I'm well out of my depth here. I'm free to admit that, but we see a lot of different technologies. We really look at the controls. So we say, how are you controlling it? But I've heard of like flow technologies, lithium ion, there's the traditional lead acid. And then there's like compressed air, flywheel. There's a bunch of like early stage technologies which are coming out of the labs, like the national labs. And I think people are starting to think about how to commercialize those. And I'm waiting with bated breath for them. I think batteries are just, lithium batteries are just so much more efficient currently that everyone's looking to lithium as the primary resource.
We need to figure out how to recycle them.
Yeah.
I think there's been a lot of talk about once it's done in a car, making it stationary, so you get more life out of it, and then you recycle it.
Because right now, it's the cost of recycling is like three times the cost of digging up more dirt. And...
Yeah, the history of power in the U.S. is something I didn't know much about before, but there are some fascinating stories of like why Texas is its own grid, and the like midnight wheeling and dealing they did to make it that case. There's why the Pacific Northwest has those big like TVA and BPA are these organizations that predated the electric grid. And there's a lot of inertia in the electric system that kind of affect all the decisions we make to this day. And so there's just a long history there of like the intuitive things that we think should make sense today, the power, the kind of there's been so much investment in, there's been so much inertia and so much like investment done in the past that it's hard to change these systems. Mm. And the rules are different for everyone because of when they came in and that type of stuff. It's a fascinating history that kind of affects so much that we don't see.
Sounds like real life, I guess.
Yes. If that was everything I wanted to cover, if there are any last questions, it was a pleasure talking with everyone.
Yeah, so I would like everyone for joining us today. I would like to thank Henry for your presentation. Maybe we can organize another one. Maybe we can talk a little bit more about storage as well, and combine it also with Ed. I think you have used some of the tools, and maybe we can do another presentation. I would also like to invite you for next Thursday at noon for our Thermal Bridge Free webinar. So it should be interesting. Please join us. And otherwise, thanks, Henry, and see you soon.
A pleasure talking. Thank you all.
Thanks.